Hello, welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church in Dayton, Texas. I'm Guy Williams, I'm pastor here, and I'm glad that you're joining us in worship today. To participate more fully in our worship service, you can download our worship guide and our hymn sheet. Also, to give toward our church's ministry, you can click the link for our secure online giving. And we would love to be in prayer with you. Click our form to let us know about prayer requests that you may have, and we would be delighted to pray for you. Today is our Blessing of the Backpack Sunday as we prepare to go back to school. So we'll be praying for our school children, for our parents, our families, for our teachers and administrators and staff and everyone who's a part of educating our children. So if you're ready for that blessing, we would invite you to be prepared to be praying along with us in our prayer time in a little bit in our service. Now, let's join in worship together.
Good morning. Please join me with the call to worship. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory in the heavens. We will be glad and rejoice in you. We will sing the praises of your name, O Most High. Please join me with the opening prayer. Almighty God, when we consider your heavens and the work of your fingers, who are we that you are mindful of us? For you have made us a little lower than the angels and crowned us with glory and honor. Grow us in grace that we may glorify you with the praise of our lips and the devotion of our lives. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Please join me in singing hymn number 77, a favorite, How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
As we gather for a time of prayer as a community of faith, today is our Sunday for going back to school, and so it's our Sunday for blessing of the backpacks traditionally. We're doing that in service. I'd like to say a prayer and to kind of bless our backpacks and bless our school year here on our online worship as well. So would you join me in prayer? Let's begin with silence. God, we give you thanks and praise for your great love for us in Jesus Christ, for your faithfulness to us, for sending us your Holy Spirit to lead and to guide us into your truth. Oh God, we're thankful that the Christian faith is both a religion of the heart and of the head, that with our hearts we love you and are fully devoted to you, and that you tell us to have our minds renewed in Christ. And Lord, we pray for everyone who is going to study this year, who is going to participate in school this year. Lord, we bless our students and our parents in Jesus' name. Students who are beginning school for the first time, or students who are going for their last first day of school, before going on to what is ahead of them in life. Lord, we pray for our teachers, for our paraprofessionals and aides. We bless them in Jesus' name. We pray for our librarians, for coaches, for music and fine arts teachers, for junior ROTC officers, for vocational tech teachers. Lord, we pray for your blessing to rest upon them, and so that the influence that they have as teachers and as mentors and influences in our children's lives, that they would not do so merely in their own strength, but they would know the strength that you provide. For our bus drivers and food service and custodial service, for our administrators, O Lord, we pray for your strength to be at work in them, for the decisions that they make, for the daily relationships that they nurture. Lord, we pray that they would be anointed with the Spirit of Christ for the students that they serve. Lord, this is such an unusual year. We pray for everyone who is beginning in person in school this year, and for those who are beginning with remote instruction. And we pray, Lord, that all of that would go smoothly, that any bumps in the road, that you would keep us patient. Lord, help us to have a spirit of grace with one another as we enter into this challenging school year. Lord, we pray for our physical safety, for health for everyone, and for respect for one another as we endeavor to advance this year of learning together. Lord, I pray for our students, but also for parents, and also for all of our school employees, that you would give us all collectively a hunger to learn and to grow. Most of all, Lord, I pray that you would give everyone in our community a hunger for Christ, that you would help us to recognize that the hunger that nothing else can satisfy is a soul-deep hunger. And as St. Augustine said, that our hearts are restless until we find our rest in you. And so, Lord, help us to go into this year with a positive attitude, with excitement and enthusiasm, with grace and perseverance, with a hunger to learn and to grow and to help others do the same. And most importantly, most centrally, to grow spiritually, to be in touch with a hunger that can only be satisfied by you. This we ask in the name of Christ, our Savior and our Lord, and we pray together as he taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please sing along with hymn number 144, This is My Father's World.
Please join me with the affirmation of faith. Church, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
Our scripture lesson today is from Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 to 28, and from Psalm 8, verses 3 through 8. Hear the word of God for you this day. Then God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground." And then in Psalm 8, beginning in verse 3, "When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them. You have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You have made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet, all flocks and herds and animals of the wild, the birds in the sky and the fish in the sea, all that swim the paths of the seas." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Would you pray with me? God, we give you thanks for your word made flesh in your Son, Jesus Christ, and for your word in the scripture through which you reveal yourself to us. And we pray in these moments together that you would speak your word, that you would write your word upon our hearts by the power of your Holy Spirit at work among us and within us. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord be with you and also with you. Now, if you are Methodist or perhaps have a background of the Episcopal Church, the Anglican Church, or maybe a Catholic background of some sort, you might recognize that interchange. And our service of Holy Communion in the Methodist tradition, we begin with a greeting that says, the pastor says, "The Lord be with you," and the congregation replies, "And also with you." Now, you need to know that because there's a story of an Episcopal priest who was having trouble with the microphone at the front of the service, and it was getting near time, and he was nervous and anxious, and the people at the soundboard were kind of figuring it out and trying to make sure that it worked. And as he was testing it, he was brought his mouth up to it, and he thought it was malfunctioning, and he said, "There's something wrong with this thing." And the people just chimed in without fully paying attention to what was going on, and they said, "And also with you. There's something wrong with this thing. And also with you." Now, I like that story because it's a good illustration that there's none of us who are without sin. Everyone has fallen short of the glory of God. No one can hold over anyone else that they're that much better than someone else. We're all in the same place before Jesus at the foot of the cross in need of God's mercy and love. Now, here's the other thing that I mean by bringing this story up is that oftentimes, we begin the human story at that place, that we're all fallen, that we all have sinned. Now, that's certainly true, but that's not the beginning of the story. In this sermon and the next 2 weeks, what I want to look at is, we're going to have a sermon series that I'm calling Origin Story. Origin Story. And what I mean by that is the backstory for why we are the way we are and how we got to this place. Now, if you've ever watched a superhero movie or a TV show or just a movie with a protagonist who's got to figure things out and you're trying to figure out what makes them tick, one of the things you want to know is what is their origin story? How did Spider-Man get all those amazing abilities? Well, he was bitten by a radioactive spider. Jason Bourne knows everything about the people and what they've been doing in the diner that he's sitting in, and he doesn't know why. He wants to figure out his origin story. why he is the way that he is. Now, that's really true of anyone's story, and here's the thing about you and I. We have a story in our head about why we are the way we are, and oftentimes what we tap into in our past is a negative story about who we are. A lot of folks struggle with this. And what I want to do in these next several weeks is to look at our true origin story, the way the Bible tells the story. Not to begin with the bad news, which is important for us to hear in order to get on to the good news of God's redemption, His love, and His restoration in Jesus Christ for us. That is tremendous news. That should be everything that defines us, really. But we forget sometimes to go back before that bad news story of human sin and turning away from God to see what the first step in the story really was, and to understand that the reason that we go from a bad place to a good place in part is because we started out in a good place in the beginning. So let's take a look. Here's what I want us to know for this first week. What I want us to understand is that we are made in the image of God, and that means that we have a royal purpose. A royal purpose. We have dignity and we have responsibility. We have a royal purpose. We are made in the image of God. Now, lest you think I'm overdoing this idea of a royal purpose to make us feel better, I want to look at these texts and see how they spoke to the places and the people that were first reading them, and understanding the difference between the God of the Bible and the gods of all the people that they knew that lived around them. Now, let's start in Genesis. Genesis 1, verse 26 to 28, tells the story on the sixth day of Genesis 1's creation account, where the writer organizes the creative works of God in sort of a seven-day pattern. It's very poetic, majestic kind of telling of creation in order to make an important point. And one of the points that he's making is that on the sixth day, on the last day that God did the creating work before he stopped back to look at everything he had done and enjoy it, that he made human beings as the very last thing. So God says, "Let us make man in our image," or mankind, or humanity. The word that is used is a word for the collective of human beings. So in one day and age, they would say man, and that was the collective term. But mankind or humankind or humanity is really what we would say more today. So let us make humankind in our image. Now, what's he mean by our? He's sort of speaking as the king upon the throne with the royal court. So it's sort of like a royal, royal collective that God is taking. He is saying, let us make man in our image, a royal, like a royal person speaking. God says, let us make humankind in our image. And so, Scripture tells us, in the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And he said, rule over all the things that he'd made up to that point. He gave him charge of all those things. Now, here's something that we need to know to understand what it meant to read this or to hear these stories when they were first coming on the scene, when the Bible was first being spoken and shared and told and then written down, is that to say, let us make humankind in our image, all of humanity in the image of God, when God said, I want to make everyone in my image, what the Bible was doing was turning something around that was very important. You see, in many of the cultures that surrounded the Hebrew people, kings or emperors would represent themselves, and the people believed them, that person, the king, to be made in the image of God and to represent God and even be regarded as an object, someone to worship, because they represented the the authority of God, the glory of God. The king was in the image of God. And so the Bible says, no, not the king is in the image of God, but God said, I want to make all of humanity in my image. I'm making humanity in my image. I have in my wallet a driver's license. And on that driver's license, there is a picture. Now, it's not the best picture I've ever taken in my life, but it is a picture that if you studied it and got it in your mind, it represents me well enough that if you saw me, you could point me out. It is an image of me. It captures enough of my likeness that you can recognize me if you understand what that image looks like. And so for God to create us in his image, that means that he has put enough of himself in humankind that our charge, our origin story, is that we bear in ourselves the image of God Almighty. That God ought to be recognized by looking at humanity. Now, isn't that absolutely amazing? The writer of the psalm thought so, because this psalm is an expression of praise and wonder. We'll read the whole thing before our series is up, but just the middle portion that I read this morning says a lot. The human being, the writer of the psalm, David or one of the others, is writing it and they're saying, when I look at all of the creation, at the moon and the stars that you have created with your fingers, when I see all of this, I am just awestruck. Who am I? What is a human being that you're mindful of me? Look at everything you've made. I'm so tiny and small, and yet here's the other thing of immense wonder and awe. Who am I that you are mindful of me, that the Son of Man, that you have endowed me with your image, that you care for me, that you have adorned me with glory and honor, that you've put everything under my feet, that you've put me in charge of this world that you've created. It's a picture of someone awestruck by the magnificence of God's creation and their smallness, and yet the royal purpose that has been given and the largeness of their dignity and worth and responsibility. You have put everything under my feet. You have put me in charge of so much. How can this possibly be? And it inspires praise and honor and wonder and humility. We are created in God's image. And that means that we have a royal purpose, and that we have dignity and responsibility. That royal purpose is that we are created in God's likeness, all of humanity, not just one representative. And then that we are given the task to rule on God's behalf. Now, this means that we all have dignity, every person. Absolutely every man, woman, and child is endowed with dignity of being made in the likeness and the image of God and representing God. The old and the young, persons of every race and ethnicity and nation, the physically fit and the disabled, the unborn child and the immigrant, everyone is made in the image of God and has that dignity and that worth. And so for Christian people and for Bible-believing people, we have no choice but to see in every human person the image of God, and to see everyone as having that stamp of dignity and worth. Everyone is created in God's image, not just the king. But furthermore, that we are given responsibility. In fact, in the psalm, I love it because our dignity in part is in light of this responsibility. It's like the complement of responsibility, the dignity of being given this opportunity to co-rule with God over his creation. Now, in the scripture, there are different words that are used. In Genesis 2, in the garden, there are words like tend and cultivate. In Genesis 1 and in Psalm 8, there are words like rule and dominion. Now, dominion doesn't mean dominate. It means authority and responsibility. Authority and responsibility. We have a stewardship under God, and a steward is someone who manages what does not belong to them. That's what you and I are. We are stewards of God's good creation. What he has shared with us is for us to manage, but it's not ours ultimately. Jesus told a parable about a man who was leaving on a trip, and he gave his servants one sum of money for one, three times that for another, and five times that for the other one. And he said, take this that I have given you, look after it until I returned. They were given something that did not belong to them, but that they had the authority and responsibility to oversee, to rule over. They were to be stewards, and they were judged according to how well they stewarded what they had been given. They were in charge of something that wasn't theirs. They had a royal purpose, as it were. I love the quote from Elizabeth Dole. She served as a cabinet secretary for two presidents, was president of the American Red Cross, and was a United States senator. Here's what she said. Life is not just a few years to spend on self-indulgence and career advancement. It is a privilege, a responsibility, and a stewardship to be lived according to a much higher calling. That captures it, doesn't it? That captures this royal purpose that we have, having been created in the image of God Almighty. Now, we know that we did not bear that image as we should, and so Jesus came, one who perfectly bore the image of God. Paul describes Jesus as being the image of the invisible God, all the fullness of God dwelling in him. And Jesus came and redeemed us, reconciled our broken relationship with God, and his work through the Holy Spirit is to restore in us the image of God in which we were created in the first place. See, God has never given up on this royal purpose that he has for human beings in his creation. To be co-rulers with him, to be stewards with the authority and the responsibility to oversee this beautiful creation that he has made. And God has dignified every person by stamping his own likeness upon them. Tom Wright, one of the great biblical scholars of our day, tells a story of being sick as a young boy. And in his house, when he was sick and he had to stay in his bed in his room and to rest and eat his soup when his mother brought it, his mother would take a mirror and she would put it outside his door in the hallway, but she would angle it so it wasn't just facing him, it wasn't just facing to the side, it was angled so that when he looked at it, he could see people who were in the hallway, and they could come and they could remain a safe distance away, and they could see him and he could see them. It was an angled mirror that allowed for a two-way visibility, so he could interact with them in his small way. Now, that image is something that he lifts up as a way to think about who we are as created in the image of God. That human beings in this creation are like an angled mirror so that we reflect God, God's goodness and mercy and love and care into the world around us. And that the world around us would be singing and lifting up God's praises, and that those would reflect through humanity, that we might praise God on behalf of all creation. I like that image. And I want to ask you, how is God calling you to fulfill that royal purpose that He has given you? He has already endowed you with all the dignity that He could possibly give you, creating you in His own image, giving His own Son to restore that image in you and me when we failed. He's never given up on that royal purpose. So that's the question for us. How has God given you an opportunity today? How is God giving you an opportunity this week to be sort of an angled mirror so that His image is reflected, that His goodness, that His mercy and grace, faithfulness and love is reflected into the world? What a blessed place this is when we recognize and pursue and live into this royal purpose that God has given us. Each of us has that dignity and responsibility. Let us pray. Oh God, we are with the psalmist, lost in wonder and in awe and in humility and praise. When we consider the vastness of the work of your fingers and the seeming equal vastness of the dignity and responsibility that you have poured into us as creatures who bear your image. Lord, help us to live into that through Christ this week. Help us to be like an angled mirror that brings your image, your goodness and mercy to bear in our world, and reflects back to you praise and gratitude. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. If God's Spirit is working in your life in such a way that you want to explore more about what it means to become a Christian, or perhaps you feel a call to go deeper in your walk with Christ, we would love to help you along your journey. Please click on our link to let us know how to get in contact with you for faith next steps, and we would be delighted to help you in your journey.
Please join me in singing hymn number 389, Freely, Freely.
Born again in Jesus.
Now receive this blessing and benediction as we go forth. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of his Holy Spirit at work within you. Go in the peace, in the power, and the presence of Christ to be his witnesses. Amen.
Take the name of Jesus with you.